This podcast episode is brought to you by Coors Light. These days, everything is go, go, go. It's nonstop hustle all the time. Work, friends, family expect you to be on 24/7. Well, sometimes you just need to reach for a Coors Light because it's made to chill. Coors Light is cold lagered, cold filtered, and cold packaged. It's as crisp and refreshing as the Colorado Rockies. It is literally made to chill. Coors Light is the one I choose when I need to unwind. So when you want to hit reset, reach for the beer that's made to chill. Get Coors Light in the new look delivered straight to your door with Drizzly or Instacart. Celebrate responsibly. Coors Brewing Company, Golden, Colorado.
Carlson, Carlson, världens bästa Carlson. Carlson, Carlson, hoj, här kommer Carlson. Carlson, Carlson, ingen faktiskt, ingen annan Carlson skulle göra så bra som mig.
Carlson, Carlson, Carlson scores!
Carlson, yeah. Carlson,
welcome, everybody, to another episode of the Keeping Carlson Fantasy Hockey Podcast, the longest-running fantasy hockey podcast in the world, hosted by two guys who have no plans to change the name of the show, no matter how much Sheng Peng makes fun of us about it. I'm your host, Elon Dubrovsky, and we've got a really fun show for you today because it is the first episode in what will hopefully be a 32-episode series called 32 Beats, where we're going to be interviewing beat writers from all around the NHL. And today we are starting with the San Jose Sharks and the great Sheng Peng, who is the number one source to talk about Sharks. So I think you're really going to like this interview. I just recorded it and it was a blast. We covered so much. So yeah, this is a really good show. Before we get into that, of course, I'll just mention that we are presented by DauberHockey.com, the number one fantasy hockey website out there. The fantasy season might be over, but the Dauber Hockey is still producing articles every day about the playoffs and just general fantasy rambling. So if you want to do well in fantasy, you should definitely be following everything going on at Dauber Hockey. And of course, the great tools over at Frozen Tools. That's DauberHockey.com. But okay, with that, I think let's just get right into my interview with Sheng Peng. Really hope you like it. Enjoy. All right, everybody, we've got a really special treat for you today because joining me for the leadoff episode of this year's 32 Beats series, we've got the best source in the world for all things San Jose Sharks, the MVP of last year's 31 Beats series of interviews with his astute Don't Draft Martin Jones advice. It is the editor-in-chief of the San Jose Hockey Now website, a really great source for all things San Jose Sharks. Welcome back to the show, Sheng Peng.
Hey, how's it going, Elon? And I like to say that I guess I was so good last year that you guys added another beat. So that's just because, solely because of me, I'm sure.
Yeah, well, it's definitely not going to be a second San Jose beat writer because there's no need for that. And yeah, I guess at some point we'll find someone from Seattle to talk to, obviously, after the expansion draft. And maybe we'll spend the whole interview talking about Ryan Donato and what impact he'll make if he comes from San Jose this year. But yeah, I'm really excited to talk Sharks with you. You know, I just recently listened to our interview from last year as a preparation, and I got to admit, it was kind of like a depressing sounding interview because Brian and I were both kind of like, you know, like the Sharks were so good in 2018-19. Like, what happened in 2019-20? Like, they fell off so hard. And then now I feel kind of bad because I feel like this is going to be another similar interview. It was another rough year for the Sharks. They pretty much matched their points percentage from 2019-20. They ended up ranking tied for sixth in the West with LA, 14 points behind St. Louis for that last playoff spot. Last year, when you helped us break down 2019-20 season, you brought up that they suffered from a lack of depth after losing like Pavelski, Nyquist, Donskoy in that offseason. And that, again, I guess appeared to be an issue in 2020-21. Though I've got to imagine another big issue must have been their goaltending. Like Martin Jones put up his third straight .896 save percentage season. The Devan Dubnyk gamble clearly did not pay off. And in the end, the Sharks had the second highest goals against, the second lowest save percentage in the league behind only Philly. So yeah, I apologize for starting on a negative note. I promise there will be some bright spots at some point, but I'd love to start by just getting your take on like what would you say is the biggest problem for San Jose this year? Like, I'm just curious, like, let's say, I know they have a lot of issues, but like, let's say they even just got average goaltending. Could this be like a much better team?
Well, let me first start off by saying that you don't have to apologize for starting on a negative note. That's the San Jose Sharks' fault. That's not your fault. in terms of just a question of if they had just average goaltending, could they have been a borderline playoff team? That's what Doug Wilson believes. Doug Wilson said that in his exit interview, that if they had better goaltending and a veteran kind of a stronger third line center, that he believed that it was a borderline playoff team. you know, maybe a team that gets to get swept by Colorado in the first round, like St. Louis did. But in terms of just the larger problem, the bigger problem for San Jose, I think it's fair to say it's a goaltending. I mean, it's not imaginative to say, but look, like, it doesn't matter how well you play. You know, if your goaltending is putting you behind the eight ball night after night, what can you do? It really doesn't matter literally how well you play. If your, you know, goaltender is giving up a bad goal to start, you know, put you down 1-0, 2-0, or whatever. Or even if you play a great game, you play a 2-2 kind of game, a toss-up sort of game. And you lose 3-2 because your goalie gave up the third goal was a little bit of an egg goal. And that's what we got a lot from Jones, and not just Jones, but Devan Dubnyk this year. And not to pile on the two young guys because it's a little unfair, but Kojunash and Melnichuk, who came in, the rookies, you know, they weren't great either. We'll just leave it at that. You know, we don't want to pile too hard on them, but just consistently the Sharks suffered from poor goaltending this year, and that is the most important part of a team, and that's sort of the foundation. If the foundation is rotten, then the rest of the, you know, the structure has no chance.
Yeah, I mean, that perfectly makes sense. So maybe then that's a potential reason to be optimistic next year, assuming they do something to fix their goaltending, which is, of course, easier said than done. Like in that interview last year, we talked about if the Sharks would bring someone in as an upgrade over Aaron Dell as a backup. And like I said, I remember we named some like appealing names, none of which were Devan Dubnyk, ended up being their choice. And then, like you said, like we did see Kochanash and Melnichuk come in right at the end of the season. Neither of them did especially well. So now, like, going into 21-22, like, are we in the same situation as last year where the Sharks will try to sign a veteran goalie to share the net with Martin Jones? Or do you think maybe finally they're going to try to figure out a way to move on from Martin Jones completely? Or is the plan just to transition to one of Kochanash or Melnichuk? Like, what do you think is the plan next year to try to turn this around?
Well, I wrote an article about this a couple weeks ago in terms of buying out Jones, and Doug Wilson did not rule that out. If you look at the money and that sort of thing, it's hard to see how this team improves and gets a new goalie, which Wilson stated clearly that they need a new starter, basically. They need to improve their goaltending. And it's hard to see how they do that without buying out Jones. Because you can sign, you know, you can keep Jones as your backup at 5.75 and sign like a Drieger type or a James Reimer, and that'll improve your goaltending in that sense. But, you know, then you're committing $8.75 million toward your goaltender, and you have, you know, one guy that you maybe feel hopeful, you know, the new guy you bring in, that's the guy that's going to kind of help you out, you know? And so instead of that, it makes more sense to buy out Jones at this point. He has 3 years left, so there's that 6-year kind of, you know, double the term. So you have a 6-year buyout penalty, and the buyout penalty is about $2 million. And so what you can do there, now you have a little more creativity there, because let's say you pay a guy like a Drieger, you know, about $3 million. I figure that's what he might make. That was the rate of kind of that caliber of goalie, I think, last year. Reimer might make about $3 million. Then you have Jones at $2 million. And then you can do, you can figure out what you want to do with that remaining money, be it give the young guy like a Kochanash, give him the backup job, or sign another kind of 1B-ish guy for about the same amount that you're paying a Reimer. So then now you have two better goaltending options in two 1B guys than just Jones and another guy, and or just Jones. By the way, though, the however you cut it, it's hard to see them coming back to Jones next year, or you know, definitely can't see him as the starter. I hope not the sake of, you know, unless he, look, I like Jones, you know, he's a good guy, and he's shown that in spurts that he can still play really well. Last March, actually, he was the player of the week actually last week in or one of the weeks in March, but in terms of just the team and the foundation of the team, you know, for 3 years it's been a struggle for him. So anyway, and then in terms of the young guys, I doubt that neither are ready to kind of take on a large role. I think at best you might see a Kochanash. Kochanash is, it looks a bit ahead of Melnichuk, at least at this point. You know, it could be a big summer for Melnichuk, but at this point, based on this year, and you can see it by the number of games that Kojinash got, that Kojinash is ahead of Melnichuk right now. And so he has kind of an inside track on the backup job or kind of the third goalie job in the organization if they get two kind of goalies in.
Okay, yeah, it's interesting, right? I guess if they buy out Martin Jones, it'll be really fun to see what they could do in free agency. You brought up like Driedger, maybe a Reimer, yeah. And Mrazek is also out there. I guess they could take a swing on a bigger name. Like I know Tuukka Rask, Frederik Andersen, though I don't know if you really want to spend a lot of money on an older goalie. So
Money kind of makes sense there now, because if you buy out, so this is why you had to buy out a Jones, because you can't keep Jones. I actually think Jones can still be a decent backup, but at his, you know, 5.75. Let's say you really try to improve your goaltending. You make you spend on Grubauer, for example, who's going to make, you know, at least Markstrom money or thereabouts from last year, right? And so that's about $6 million, right? So you know, can you combine Grubauer's potential $6 million, 5.5, whatever, right, with Jones's 5.75, and suddenly you're spending money on goaltenders like you're the Vegas Golden Knights. And I guess you can afford to do that if the rest of your team is constructed better in different places like the Golden Knights are, but San Jose's team is not constructed well in other places, just in terms of money spent on positions. And so so if you want to bring in, let's say, a Grubauer, then you definitely have to buy out a Jones, because then at that point, then you can do Grubauer at 5.5, Jones' cap hit at about $2 million, and then Kojinash, so let's say, as your backup, you know, at basically close to the minimum. And then that's about, you know, $8.5 million spent overall on your goaltending. So
yeah, well, all of a sudden, then it would definitely make it more appealing to draft a San Jose goalie in fantasy. I wonder what the market would be for Martin Jones if he got bought out, like if any team would sign him maybe for $1 million or $2 million. I don't know if I would.
Yeah, I don't know.
My favorite team signed him.
I think that he might be one of those guys. He'll definitely get a tryout, you know, kind of that sort of thing, right? And he might have a nice preseason and win a job that way. Or a team might give him, like, I don't think he'll get $2 million. That's pretty rich for, at least for the, you know, the free agency market these days, which we expect to be as, you know, buyer friendly a market as it was last year. But I can see him getting maybe a 1 year, just because he has so much experience, and he did show in spurts last year. Like I mentioned, you know, he had a great March, mm-hmm. was a player of the week, you know, for one of those weeks. So that's pretty good. If your backup is able to give you, you know, has that capability in him to kind of carry you for a month, which I think it's fair to say Jones did. Sharks were pretty good in that month, and to get and earn a player of a week. That's actually, you know, for a backup, that's actually a pretty high ceiling.
Yeah, I remember actually. Yeah, it looked like the Sharks maybe could still challenge for a playoff spot with that. Like, I think it was like a 4 or 5 game winning streak in March, but then it all fell apart. They had a really terrible end to the season.
Right.
Okay, so let's move on to our podcast namesake. I know last year in the interview, you suggested that we change it to Keeping Carlson with a C, and we kind of laughed with it, but I guess you were on to something, because Erik Karlsson, man, in that interview, we were talking about, like, could we please have the, like, you know, what is the chance that 2019-20 was just an aberration? He only had a 59 point pace. When is he going to get back to, like, the 70 point Carlson that he had been before? And then at this point, like, I would love if he could go back to just what he did in 2019-20, because this past season was like not anything that any of us predicted. He had the worst offensive season of his career, only 22 points in 52 games for a 35 point pace, not even half point per game. He actually even scored more goals this season than in the previous year and in fewer games. So it wasn't that he wasn't scoring goals. He was taking like a similar number of shots, which was still a lot fewer shots than he used to, like only 3 a game, when he used to be more like closer to 3. But still, like, he was scoring goals, but those assists just completely disappeared. Only 14 assists this year compared to 34. So I guess this year I'm going to ask a similar question about Erik Karlsson as I did last year, but just with updated numbers. Is the 60-ish point Erik Karlsson from 2019-20, do you think that's a thing of the past now? Or is there a chance that Karlsson could get back to at least being somewhat relevant as an offensive producer?
Well, Wilson seems to think so. Once again, in his exit interview, he still believes, and maybe he has to say it because Erik Karlsson has 6 years left on his contract, but he says that he believes that Karlsson is still one of the great defensemen in the league, acknowledges that Karlsson did not have a good year this year. In terms of just pure point production, I find it hard to see Karlsson being a 60-70 point guy again. I don't know if 35 is right, because I still see a lot of offensive talent. You know, his... talked to a scout, and scout did not like Carlson's game this year, but says that his hockey brain is still there, and it is still there. You know, he called Carlson's hockey brain a 20 million hockey brain. And so Carlson still sees a lot of stuff out there that very few people can see, and he still can execute, you know, uncork a beautiful pass here and there, that sort of thing. There's still a lot of offensive talent there, just suffice to say. But in terms of just pure point production, I'm expecting, you know, more in the 40-ish, 50-ish range, something that you know, it's still a nice total, a nice amount. But of course, though, with Carlson, you can't escape it. And it's, you know, a little unfair in some ways. But hey, once you sign a contract like that, it's going to be part of the conversation the whole time. And so he is the highest paid defenseman in the league, and still, at least at this moment. But I don't know if the production is going to be at that level ever again.
And do you think that's more just because of like his aging and like the injury, like the groin injury? Like last year when we were talking, you were saying that maybe he just needed more time to recover from that groin injury and maybe he'd be fine this year. But you also brought up that maybe it's just because the Sharks like lack of depth at forward, like maybe that's not helping with the defensemen to get as many points as they used to. Like, what do you think the reason is? And I guess I could ask a similar question about Brent Burns,
sure,
who also had a huge dip. Like he had an 83-point pace in 2018-19 and then only a 53-point pace in 2019-20 and then also fell again this past year as a 35-year-old, only 29 points in 56 games for a 42-point pace. So I guess we'll get to Burns in a little bit, but just in general, I'm curious for Carlson, do you think it's more about just aging and injury, or is it more about just the Sharks aren't a team that can support such an amazingly highly offensive defenseman?
I think it's all the factors. I mean, it doesn't help that the Sharks don't have a lot of finishers, great finishers on the team. You know, one of the interesting things about the Sharks this year is that they actually did a really good job in terms of creating chances in tight. If you look at their expected goals as a team, that sort of thing, they actually did quite well in that 5-on-5. You know, you'd be surprised to see. I think they were like the fourth best team in the league, 5-on-5 in expected goals, which is not what you would expect. But it's because Bob Bugner installed the offensive system that, and we'll get to this with Brent Burns, but installed an offensive system that really emphasized the shots in closer, you know, shots below the dots in the slot, that sort of thing. There's just that kind of high danger area. And so anyway, Carlson was a part of that in terms of, you know, there a lot of passes you see from Eric Carlson get into that slot area, but it's to a guy that just didn't finish that right. Part of the job. But also too, and it's hard to say because when you talk to people, it sounds like there's nothing physically in terms of, you know, like what doctors are seeing, that sort of thing. There's nothing physically wrong with Eric Carlson. But you know, some guys, and it could be just the kind of accumulation of injuries and that sort of thing, but it's not like it's something you'll see in an MRI, but just that he's just kind of slowed down and, you know, he's slowing down a little bit earlier. You know, crossing 30 in general is always a, you know, kind of a time when you question, oh, you know, is a guy about to slow down anyway? And we've seen this over the years, but maybe he's a guy that slowed down maybe a little bit more. And that's a combination of age and injury and that sort of thing. But it is hard to pinpoint. You know, if we could pinpoint it, then, you know, maybe you could solve it, but it's hard to pinpoint exactly what's sort of gone wrong with him. But it's also hard, you know, again, because he's crossed 30, it's hard to think that all of a sudden we're going to see 2016 Eric Carlson, you know, again next year, unfortunately, you know, or even 2018-19 Eric Carlson, who just as a reminder was still an incredible player and in San Jose. But it's just, you know, the farther away you get from his best hockey, which I think was roughly January 2019, when he was before that groin injury, the farther away we get from that, it's hard to see, you know, him returning to form.
Yeah, which is a bummer because, like you said, there's still quite a few years left of that $11.5 million per year contract. I still hold out a little bit of hope that Carlson can surprise us.
I hope so too. I love watching him play when he's at his best. In terms of a player that I've covered, I've not enjoyed watching a player more than him just when he's right. But unfortunately, just to make another jibe at your podcast name, keeping Carlson won't be the good thing that it's been for the past decade. So it's going to be, if you're a baseball fan, something like a keeping Albert Pujols or something like that. So.
Right, okay, yeah. Well, at least there's some more Carlsons in the league that we could maybe.
Exactly. There's William Carlson, who's, you know, good for a good 20 goals a year at least. So.
Yeah, and going on a playoff run right now.
Exactly.
This is crushing Colorado today on Sunday night. I love that one game that Carlson had this season where he scored the overtime goal and then he was eating that apple in the press conference afterwards, and someone asked him, like, is this your best game you've ever had in your career? And he was like, not even close. That was a good moment.
That was good, and he's still good for moments like that. And I, again, you know, that's part of, like, you know, the fun and the challenge. You know, it, as a reporter, it can be, and I'll preface that I was not the one who asked that question. And
no, I'm sure.
That was not a great question. but though, yeah, like, you know, so as a reporter, sometimes you got to be careful with the person with that kind of, how do you say it, you know, that kind of confidence, you know, and when he's right and his game is right, you know, and, you know, he's, you know, riding high. But then it also makes for great moments too, just because you see, I guess the way to put it is you get to see a player's real personality in moments like that. And so whether or not that question was a great one or not, you got to see, you know, really a glimpse of just sort of, you know, Erik Karlsson, you know, kind of a master of the world, you know, for a moment there, a brief moment there. And we saw that from time to time last year, but obviously not enough. And hopefully we do see more of that, you know, yeah, more and more of those moments.
Yeah, we'll talk more about the rest of this team that can maybe help him get there. But yeah, speaking of Burns, I just want to mention that, you know, beyond just the point decrease, which was obviously disappointing, like, his shot rates really plummeted. Like, he only had 2.5 shots per game, and he had been well over 3 shots per game and even approaching 4 in some seasons. Like, the past 5 years, he's been well over 3. Also, Burns only managed 6 power play points, which I guess isn't surprising. I checked, the Sharks were the 3rd worst team at the man advantage. They only converted at 14.1% of their opportunities. So I'm curious, if you had to pick one guy between Burns and Carlson to show a bit of a bounce back, at least offensively, in 2021-22, like, who would your pick be?
I think it'd still be Burns, because part of the thing you can see with just how coaches use the both of them. Well, first for Burns, again, you know, there's age, and I think there has been some slippage there. I think that it'd be naive not to acknowledge that. But though, the Sharks use them differently, though. The Sharks use them as their kind of top defensive defenseman, paired with Mario Ferraro. They were together basically the whole season. And one area where you can see it, and this also helps explain the drop in the shot rate, is Burns's offensive zone faceoff rate, in terms of just you know, being deployed in that way. I think he received on average per 60 7 less per 60 at 5-on-5 offensive zone faceoffs per 60 this year than he did in kind of the peak of the DeBoer era, you know, when Brent Burns was, you know, well, master of the world, you know, so about 2015 to 2019. And that's obviously going to eat into your shot total if you're being asked to kind of concentrate, conserve more of your energy on the defensive end. And so Carlson was given a little more of those, kind of that little more of that offensive push. So I think that is a one reason why Burns's totals kind of went down, his shot rate went down. But also too, just that there was more of the trust in Burns, though, to take on a greater role, even a greater defensive role. And so I have more hope for a guy like that, just in the sense that the coaches trust him more. And I think based on what I saw last year, I don't disagree with that. Last year, you know, anything could happen next year, of course. But, and also finally, in terms of the shot rate, I think another big factor for the drop for Burns and also for Carlson is the coaching system. You know, I mentioned the expected goals and how well the Sharks did on that 5-on-5. Well, expected goals, as you know, of course, is a lot to do with shot quality in terms of getting shots in tight more. And there was a large emphasis on the Sharks to do that instead of traditionally, you know, what we saw under Peter DeBoer, which is a lot of it was get the puck back to Burns at the point and let Burns find a way to get it to the front, where you had a guy like Joe Pavelski to tip it in or to at least create chaos there. And we saw Bugner go completely, really completely. It was actually interesting because Bugner was a, you know, a DeBoer acolyte. Bugner was a DeBoer assistant in 2016 when the Sharks made the finals. So it's interesting to see Bugner go completely away from what his sort of his predecessor, you know, the guy he worked for in San Jose in 2016 and in 2019-20 before DeBoer got fired, go completely away from what DeBoer was doing. And another way where we can see this illustrated too was in the DeBoer, the last couple of years with DeBoer, 2018-19, for example, the Sharks were second in the league in terms of percentage of defenseman shots at 5-on-5 with a total shot share. So basically, I think it was like 39% of the Sharks 5-on-5 shot attempts in 2018-19 were by their defensemen. That was a very high number. That, like I said, I was second in the league, right?
Yeah, I feel like Burns was like leading the league in shots.
Right. Oh, yeah. No, he was leading the league by a huge number, you know, back then. And that was basically sort of the nexus of the offense. And a lot of people criticize that because, oh, you know, like point shots aren't efficient, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, Sharks weren't looking for efficiency. They're looking for volume. They're looking for pressure, too. You know, even the shot doesn't go in, it's pressure. And also, too, Burns wasn't shooting the score often from back there. They counted as shots on goal, but, you know, Burns was looking for tips. Burns was looking for all that kind of, you know, all that kind of traffic, all that good stuff. And overall, you can't argue with the results of Burns' numbers. You mentioned 83-point pace or 83-point season in 2018-19, and the Sharks were a conference finals team. But anyway, so going back to that stat, though, the Sharks this past year under Bugner, I think late in the season at least, I didn't track it till the very end of the season. Basically, late into April, the Sharks were last or 30th in the league in terms of the shot share by defensemen at five shot attempt share by defensemen at 5-on-5 at like something like 26%, you know. And so that speaks to not just Burns and Carlson, but just a different philosophy. Basically, that's the whole point that Bugner really emphasized. And we saw, you know, that proof in the pudding in terms of just the expected goals and the shot quality that improved for the Sharks.
Which I guess all that said must mean if they're happy with you know, rise in expected goals, that must mean that we should probably not expect Burns to go back to being that 3 shots per game guy.
Right. The offense is not intended to orbit around him anymore like it was under DeBoer.
Right, makes sense. Then I guess before we move on to the forwards, is there like any other defenseman that you see coming up soon that can also challenge to be like, you know, an offensive producer? Like, I know Mario Ferraro had a big season for the Sharks like, as a defensive player. I saw you wrote an article recently at San Jose Hockey Now that says Mario Ferraro will turn your franchise around, which is a fun quote. So, but yeah, I assume that, like, yeah, he had played a lot of minutes, especially for a sophomore. But in terms of offense, though, I'd love to hear you just like rave about Mario Ferraro if you'd like. But yeah, I know like Ryan Merkley is coming up and some people expect him to at some point be a big deal, though I noticed in an interview I heard with you recently, like he wasn't even on the top power play in the AHL in the playoffs recently. So I don't know, is there like the one thing I guess going for Burns and Carlson in my mind is they're still going to be like getting the power play time,
right,
getting the offensive minutes. Do you see that changing anytime soon? Like, is there anyone else that's a challenger?
Yeah, no, I do not. I think that, you know, Ferraro did see some PP2 time, but he's not, you know, he's a great player, but he's definitely more defensively oriented. He has offensive talent. He actually, I think, does a pretty good job at the point, but, you know, I think he will not challenge Burns or Carlson for legitimate power play time. He won't replace either of them. Speaking of Merkley, yeah, Merkley, I think, is very, very far away, unless he has an amazing summer this summer, but based on what I saw this year and based on what I hear from people inside and outside the organization, it's hard to see him kind of having that that offensive impact at NHL level very soon, a high level at least. He still has a lot to work on, obviously, in his defensive game, you heard, but there's still a lot to work on. I wrote about this. I talked with Barracuda coach Roy Sommer, who guy sort of gave a season review of 2020-21, and he mentioned that Merkley still has a lot to work on offensively. And we saw that in just the production. I think Merkley had 11 points in 31 AHL games, which is not, you know, what you would expect out of a talent like him. And he was on the second power play unit, at least by the time they got to the end of the season. And when they had their little Pacific Division playoffs thing, he was on the second power play unit behind, you know, Robbie Russo, an AHL veteran, not a guy that, you would expect to be much of an obstacle for a guy of Merkley's kind of natural offensive talent. But it shows that he has a lot to learn about just the subtleties of offensive game. It's not just about having incredible vision or being able to uncork Erik Karlsson-like pass, which Merkley can do, and very few people in NHL can do something like that. But there's other just small things. You know, Sommer wanted Merkley to shoot more, to just, you know, have to keep it simple in some ways, you know, and just things like that on a night-to-night basis. And so even though points aren't always a great way to judge how a player is doing, I think in this case, and again, based on things I'm hearing, not just within the organization, but outside of it, that I think that's an accurate reflection of where Merkley's offensive game is at. Right now. And so again, if there's not, unless there's a huge leap, you know, it's hard to see him just stepping in and taking, you know, really challenging a Burns or Karlsson next season.
Right. So maybe if you're in a dynasty league and you're wanting to contend soon, you might want to trade Ryan Merkley if you could get something good for him, is what I'm hearing between the lines. Yeah. Okay,
yes.
So I promised to bring up some bright spots this year. So let's go to the forwards. And one player who had an amazing year, a career year, and it's like, I think last year in our interview, there wasn't one player that we brought up that had a career. Like, every player had a down year in 2019-20. But in 2021, Evander Kane did the best he's ever done. He had a monster season. And this is despite, like, that off-ice issue at the beginning of the season. The whole bankruptcy thing didn't matter. He put up 22 goals and 49 points in 56 games, which equates to a 32-goal, 72-point pace, crushing his previous career high of a 63-point pace way back when he was on the Jets. And perhaps even more impressive is the fact that he did this with the Sharks having like that weak power play that I mentioned. He only had seven power play points, which had him pacing for less than half of the power play points he had in 2019-20. So it means that he, you know, did all of this at even strength, which generally is more repeatable. And maybe, who knows, I should ask you if you have any idea if the Sharks might improve this power play moving forward. So yeah, not to jinx it, but like I said, Evander Kane, this huge year. Also, he was like healthy. He played every single scheduled game of the season, which is the first time he's ever done that of his career. So I'm curious, like, what do you think led to Kane having such a big uptick in his production this season? And do you think he's a good bet to once again lead the team in scoring next year and be this like 70-plus point guy?
Yeah, so I think with Evander, I think a couple things helped. Number one just is role. You know, he's a 20-minute a game winger. I don't think there's a ton of wingers out there that play as much as Evander does. Usually that kind of ice time for a forward is reserved for centermen. And so I think that helps a bit. You know, he's all situations, power play, even though if he didn't score a lot of power play, but he obviously got some points out of there. But also shorthanded too. He was a weapon shorthanded this year. And so he's a regular penalty killer for the Sharks. And obviously just 5-on-5 time, and he's a crunch time guy for the Sharks. In terms of and also another big element too, and this doesn't necessarily help me in fantasy, but he did a good job of staying out of the box this year. Early in the season, he was on a tear in a bad way in terms of just, you know, getting to, you know, double minors or, you know, whatever, that sort of thing. So early in the season, Bob Bogner talked to him, like, you got to cut this stuff out. You got to, you know, we want you to be playing. We don't want you in the box. And he did actually a really good job in the last three quarters of the season of staying on the ice. And you can see that too. I think Kane led the league in penalty minutes the last 2 years. This year, not even close. And so I think that was one element that helped him too. He just stayed on the ice. And so I think those are two huge factors for him and his production. But in terms of him being a good bet to once, you know, to be a 70 point guy, that sort of thing, you know, he's a guy that hasn't even hit 60 points. So I wouldn't draft him in fantasy as a guy that's, you know, a point per game guy or anything close, even though he had a season that was pretty close to that. If you can get him at a value of a 50 point guy, that sort of thing, maybe he'll surprise you and tick into 60 and, you know, cross over 30 goals. And he'll still add a good number of penalty minutes. So in that sense, I think if you get him in the right place, then that's good. But I don't know if I would see him. You know, he's a little bit older. He's about to cross 30 as a guy that is suddenly a point per game guy. I will say that he is an incredibly talented player when he's at his best. He's always had kind of issues with consistency that I've seen. And so maybe he has kind of figured that out in terms of just being more consistent. That does happen with guys. They sort of mature, that sort of thing. But just my guess, just based on past production, that sort of thing, and past inconsistency. inconsistencies that I think that that was probably more likely where we're going to where he's going to go next year. And that this season was, you know, helped that he had the shortened season. They don't have the chances to have the cold spells in the shortened season because they play, you know, of course, 26 less games.
Yeah, that's a smart point. Like, I'm bringing him up, like, he just had a 70-point year, but, like, it's only a 70-point pace, and, like you said, he's never even passed a 60-point season when you count for all the games that actually got played. So, yeah, so maybe Evander Kane will be a little bit, like, overrated to some people going into next year if they're hoping he could do everything exactly the same. Though, yeah, really great season. Yeah, I guess I brought up the power play. I don't think I've really asked you about it yet. Mm-hmm. Like, do you think that they have a chance or any plan to sort of improve things next year? Like, I still don't really get what the plan is with, like, Burns and Carlson. Like, I know, like, when Carlson first arrived, they sometimes had them both on the power play at the same time, and sometimes, you know, they'd have them split. And like this year with the power play struggling so much, have you got any sense of like what they're going to try to do next year? Like, one thing I've always kind of wondered is if Timo Meier will ever get a shot on the top power play, since he's someone who's always absent. Yeah, I'm just curious, like, what you think is the reason why the power play struggled so much this year, and like what's the right step to try to fix that?
Well, I would just guess a lot of it is just the players just aren't as good as you expect them to be, and specifically Carlson and Burns. But I think it's a little confounding, though. I think they're confounded with what to do, too, because they started the season, as they've done the last three seasons, put Burns at the OV spot, put Carlson up top. That doesn't work. Okay, split them. And actually, I was an advocate for splitting them on the power play, because I think that worked better in 2018-19 when they had a top 10 power play. But the problem with that is that, again, you know, Carlson was not as good this year. He was the PP1 guy when they were split, and Burns also not as good, but also too, Burns didn't have as much to work with. 2018-19, when you did split a Carlson and Burns, whoever got the second unit still had Evander Kane was a second unit guy in 2018-19. Joe Thornton, who was still a 50-point guy back then, was also on your second unit. Timo Meier was on your second unit. And so that's a pretty good second unit, right? Whereas this year, if you were the defenseman that got the second unit, you know, you were still playing. Yeah, I think Timo was still on a second unit. Hurdle was on at times, so that's a good start. But then you have guys, you know, a revolving door of John Leonard, Patrick Marleau, that sort of thing. Ryan Donato on there. So guys who weren't quite as successful on a, you know, just didn't have the resumes in terms of, or recent resumes, I'm sorry, because obviously Patrick Marleau's a 500-goal guy, but recent resumes like 2018-19 when, again, you know, you had Kane, you had a still very good Joe Thornton, Gustav Nyquist, Timo Meier on your second unit.
So yeah, I guess you're not seeing lots of reasons to expect the power play to improve too much next year.
Right. Well, and actually, let me mention the other part, actually. So they split them apart. That didn't work out. And eventually, by the end of the season, they put Carlson and Burns back together, but then they flip-flopped them, whereas Burns was up top, which I think I always thought Burns was more comfortable up there, which is why Burns at the OV spot didn't really work out. And Carlson was more on the other side, kind of the half wall, not the one-timer spot, playmaker spot. Spot, you know, right-handed shot on the right wall, mm-hmm. more of a playmaking spot, and so so you have three different kind of schematics with your Burns Carlson, and nothing really worked, and so we'll see if. You know, in terms of something working, I think it just depends on Carlson and Burns really like coming back to form. But again, as we talked about, I don't know if that's going to happen.
Yeah, probably not something you want to bank on.
Credit Karma has always been there to help you make better financial decisions. And now they want to help you even more. With a Credit Karma Money Spend account, you can be rewarded for good money habits. Credit Karma Money is a brand new checking account where you can win cash reimbursements for making purchases. Just pay with your debit card, and if you win, you'll be notified on the spot and your Instant Karma cash will be added back to your spend account. Open your FDIC-insured spend account for free. There's no minimum balance requirements, no overdraft fees, and free withdrawals from a network of over 50,000 ATMs. And when you make a purchase between June 8th and June 30th, you'll automatically be entered to win $1 million. Right now, visit creditkarma.com/winmoney to open your free account and start winning Instant Karma. Go to creditkarma.com/winmoney to sign up for free and start winning. That's creditkarma.com/winmoney. Instant Karma is sponsored by Credit Karma. No purchase necessary. Exclusions and terms apply. See rules. Banking services provided by MVB Bank Incorporated. Member FDIC. Maximum balance and transfer limits apply.
So we mentioned Timo Meier. An interesting part of our interview last year is you were saying that Timo Meier sort of like had that great year in 2018-19, like most of the Sharks, 30 goals, 69 points. Then he fell to a 57-point pace in 2019-20. And then we were asking you, like, which is the real version of Timo Meier? And you said that you felt like he was playing his, like, B game in 2019-20. And if he could, like, reach his A game, like, maybe he could still be that 30-plus point guy. Unfortunately, he, I guess, stuck with his B game or maybe even fell to his C game in 2020-21.
Yeah, a little more C.
Yeah, like, only 18 goals, 47-point pace. It was an 18-goal pace, yeah. So I'm curious to get your updated sense of Timo Meier. Like, do you still think this A game is in him to be this 30-plus goal guy? Or after what we saw this past season, is there some reason to be concerned? Like, I see, like, I don't know, in his defense, like, he only had a 7.7 shooting percentage, which was well below his number in the previous three seasons. But also, like, Bugner doesn't seem to like him that much. Like, he had a dip in his time on ice and his power play time compared to previous seasons. So I'm just curious to know, like, how much of this downer should we attribute to, like, a fall-off in his play versus maybe Bugner not giving him enough opportunity?
Well, I don't know. I don't think it's a coach is a like kind of like the coach not liking him. I think it's the guy's play. Like, his game was probably closer to 2C, you know, B or C this year, and so the time on ice kind of showed that. You know, in terms of the shooting percentage, I do get that things kind of happen. But I think you know, Timo scores. He's a volume shooter kind of guy. And so I don't know if he's a great finisher also anyway. So if they're not going in for him, you know, then, you know, how else, you know, he's not going to all of a sudden, you know, when it's not going in for him, find, you know, he doesn't have a go-to move kind of to score, be it like a OV one timer or that sort of thing to kind of, you know, get him out of his schneid, you know, like a sweet spot or something like that, where you can expect him to score. So anyway, in terms of just his usage and his production versus usage, you know, once again, you know, I think you earn your ice time. And so in his limited kind of more limited 5-on-5 time, I think his points per game this year at 5-on-5 was something like 1.6, 1.7, not really that high. And so, you know, you want to earn the coach's time and get into the Vander Kane 20 minute, you know, a night winger time, you got to produce. And he did not. And so, sure, the shooting percentage I can see bounce back. And I do think he has the talent for it. I do think that there is an A game in him. And I think that he is a guy that who should be a 30-goal-a-year guy, you know, easy every year. So I do think that of Timo. But in terms of just, you know, what happened this year, the game just wasn't there. You know, you saw bits and flashes of it. I don't know if it maybe just got into his head a bit. You know, when guys don't score, they're snake bit, you know, they're sort of a mental thing. You know, there wasn't, he did deal with a couple of nagging injuries, but for the most part, I don't think it was a physical thing with him. I think one thing that can help him too is that, I'm not sure. One of the things that Bugner critiqued about him, and you can kind of see in the stats, was that his high danger chances at 5-on-5, individual high danger chances, his rate wasn't as high as it has been in the past season. Usually he has five high danger chances per 60, which is a kind of a league leading or up there amount. This year it was closer to four. And so there was kind of a drop in that. And Bugner talked a lot about Timo's game being too perimeter. And so if he can kind of shake himself out of that and maybe play that style that I think the coaching staff wants out of him, then, you know, as he kind of just piles up chances, and the more high danger they are, then they'll start to kind of go in. And then we'll start to see maybe that kind of 30 goal guy. But, you know, that's a lot of that's on Timo, though. He's got to attack the net. He's got to, you know, pass a little bit less kind of into the slot and just take the puck to the net like he can.
Yeah, like Meyer's still only 24 years old, so I guess there still is time for him to figure things out. But yeah, hopefully next year he'll be able to start bouncing back a little bit. I guess we'll see what kind of resilience he has. And then, okay, another guy I'm really curious to get your take on is Logan Couture, because if we were doing this interview around mid-March, I'd be asking you about, like, wow, Logan Couture is having this amazing season. Like, he's found a whole new gear. Like, at that point, at one point this season, he had 22 points through 24 games, which is a 75-point pace, which would have been the highest of his career. But then, like, out of nowhere, Couture, it's like he hit some sort of invisible wall and he just completely stopped. Like, he went cold and only had 9 points in his final 29 games. His shot rates like completely disappeared. Any idea what happened there in the middle of March? Did he like eat something bad, or did like how did he all of a sudden go from having a career year to completely disappearing so quickly?
Yeah. I actually, at midseason, I was looking at some numbers. He actually was second in the league in even strength goals. He was tied with Austin Matthews, Connor McDavid. The only guy he was behind for even strength goals at the midpoint of the season was Mikko Rantanen. So that's a good, great, company to be in. Of course, he just totally dropped off.
I'll admit to you, like, I had Logan Couture in my main fantasy league, mm-hmm. a couple, and, like, Brian was actually telling me that I should probably try to trade him because he's probably overperforming. I was like, come was on, no, he's doing so well, and I held on, and then I ended up actually dropping him before the end of the year because he was just doing nothing for me.
Yeah, so anyway, though, I think a lot of it, though, is probably injury, though. We know he had a foot injury, lower body injury, and I think he played through it, but I would guess that. There's nothing else, guys do drop off from year to year. Of course, you see that all the time, and Logan is in his 30s, but we don't see too often that in season, though, right? A guy just totally drops off quite like that, right? Like, guys fade throughout a season. They don't drop off a cliff in season. So I would guess that is going to be the main thing with him, and that is always going to be a risk with him because, Couture, captain of the team, and he plays like most captains of the team do, all out with his body, blocking shots. He was used this year as sort of the Sharks' top defensive center, which maybe he's a little miscast as, just in terms of, not that he's not good enough for it, but, you want to kind of keep him for a little more offense and, save him, save his face-offs, save his face-offs, his zone starts, that sort of thing. And the Sharks, with their lack of depth, were forced to kind of use him as they're kind of everywhere, we got to win a face off defensive zone, we gotta hold a 3-2 lead, that sort of guy, that guy at all times. And so hopefully next year they can add to their center depth, and so he gets to do a little bit less of that, and that may keep him away from injury, like a foot injury, lower body injury, that's going to slow down his production.
Yeah, so as of now, is the idea that he will be at full health for next year? It's just
I mean, okay. He played through it. He did sit out the last few games when the Sharks were mathematically eliminated. But everything that he said that's been communicated is that it's not even something that I don't think it'll require surgery. But yeah, there's every expectation that he'll be at full health. And so he might be a guy that might be a good sleeper pickup if, people are judging him just based on, I guess, his total season, just the overall kind of overall not great stats just because of how he dropped off in the second half. So
yeah, that definitely makes a lot of sense, because like you said, he was like right up there among the league's best.
Yep.
For those first 25 games. So far I've only been talking to you about the same players that we talked about last year, so I want to end with some of the new players who joined the Sharks this year and really made quite an impact. And one name that jumps off the page to me is 26-year-old Alex Barabanov, who the Sharks acquired from Toronto around the trade deadline. And like, he was barely able to crack the Leafs lineup, didn't do much when he did for most of the season, but the story was like completely different on the Sharks. He was right away given like 17 plus minutes in most of the 9 games he played. So yeah, it's only 9 game sample, so very small,
right?
But also during that time he was getting top power play time, and he delivered. He had 3 goals and 4 assists for 7 points in 9 games right at the end of the season. Again, I'm talking about Alex Barabanov, 7 points in 9 games. So is there a chance what we saw from this guy was for real, and he's someone that should be on people's radars when looking at potential, I guess, sleepers for next season?
Maybe a sleeperish guy, guy that you hope will put up like 30, 40 points for you. I mean, his pace with the Sharks, I mean, what is that? 7 points, 9 games. That's
65.
60. Yeah, that's not going to happen. I mean, if you look at his KHL numbers, he had one season, I think, where he averaged about a point per game. But his other seasons, he was more about, half a point per game, 0.6 or something like that. And so I think that's probably a more reasonable expectation for his NHL ceiling. I wouldn't get too excited about the sample size, but he was a legit. I mean, I watched him very carefully just to kind of see, what he was and what he could potentially bring to the Sharks next season. And he did look like there's a chance that he could be a legit middle six kind of winger, a guy, again, in that point range in terms of just pure production of 30, 40 that can fill in. I don't think you really want him on your first power play just because I don't think he's a PP1 guy in the NHL. If your team is, you know, loaded, like the Leafs were, obviously. At least the Leafs at forward, at least. So I don't know if that's necessarily where you want him. But, you know, he's a guy that I think can, you know, be good on a PP2. And you know, if there's an injury, he can help you out in your top six from time to time, or be a good complementary kind of second line guy. So I do think that he does have that value.
Yeah, he definitely is on my radar now. And let's not go crazy, but it was exciting to see. And also just that opportunity like that we saw him get at the end of the year. So obviously, Boone right. liked him somewhat. Another key acquisition seemed to be Rudolph Balcers, who the Sharks traded for Carlson back, you know, a couple seasons ago. But then they got the opportunity to reclaim him when he was waived by the Sens at the start of the year. And clearly he was someone who the Sharks liked more than the Sens. He quickly worked his way up the lineup. He played the majority of the season with Meyer and Hurdle on, I guess, the second line. If you say like Evander Kane and Couture is the top line. But either right. way, like Balcers had a couple nice runs, like in late February and early April, had 10 points in his first 15 games. But then actually, a lot like Logan Couture, he went super cold down the stretch, only 5 points in his final 20 games. So his final season numbers aren't that great. Which version of Balcers do you think will be more representative of what we should expect next season? Like that first initial start with those 10 points in 15 games, or more the like cold guy at the end of the year?
Well, I think like a lot of young guys, I think it's going to be a little bit of both, actually, where it's going to be he's going to be inconsistent. He's going to have these nice runs, but he's also going to have these cold spells. But I think like Barabanov, you talk about his hot start and his cold spell. Overall, that's what 15 points, 35 games. That ends up being over an 82 game season. That's about a high 30, 40 point scorer. And I see that as a Balzer's rough ceiling. And so, it just depends on your expectations. If you're drafting him to be that guy who can kind of, that can kind of fill in and do that, then I think he can execute that again, kind of a middle six-ish forward. If you're expecting him to step in and be like a surefire second line or kind of a borderline first line forward at, 50 points or whatever, I'm not sure if that's what I see from him. But I think he is a good, solid player. And I do think that the good that we saw in him was legitimate.
That's cool. Yeah. So I guess you're saying like sort of for the Sharks' sake, if they want to be a really good team, maybe you don't want Barabanov and Balcers being your top line guys, but maybe for now that's what they have to deal with. I'm curious to know like what you think of some of these other guys that maybe got chances throughout the year in the top six, just to get a sense of like who are maybe people who have potential to have an impact next year. Like guys like Noah Gregor, John Leonard, Alexander True all got some opportunities right at the end of the season. None of these guys made huge offensive impacts. So yeah, I guess just in general, like, is there anyone that played this past season aside from like Barabanov and Balcers, like some of these guys, like I said, Gregor, Leonard, True, do any of them strike you as someone who might, surprise us next year and get a decent role and do something?
Sure. I think Gregor and Leonard show some flashes. Gregor has obvious, he is probably the Sharks' fastest skater. He has a good shot, very good shot. But I think his game needs more variety. Like if you take away his speed and his shot, doesn't really add too much else. Leonard, we saw flashes, good playmaker, very patient with the puck. So I think for both of those guys, it's about adding other layers to their game so they can't be shut down in that sort of those areas that they do well in. And I think they both have potential to be 20 goal guys. I don't know if it's going to happen next year. I would say Gregor maybe a little ahead of Leonard just because Gregor is more experienced. Mm-hmm. So Gregor has a couple NHL years under his belt as opposed to Leonard only having one. So Gregor might be a good kind of sleeper guy that might surprise you and pop in, not going to be a second line, first line guy, but, a good middle six guy, legit, top nine forward in NHL. True, though, I think he profiles more as a 4C in the future, I think, at least at NHL level. He had an excellent NHL season. He was actually the Barracuda MVP, voted on by the Barracuda coaching staff and management. So that's a legitimate honor. Wasn't voted on by the fans, no offense to the fans or by the media, So yeah, it was by the coaching staff, which I think is a big deal. It shows what they thought of Alex's game this year. But at NHL level, though, again, I see him more as a 4C. So he may be a good fourth line center, but it's not going to provide you a lot of kind of offensive impact, though.
Noah Gregor, by the way, I should mention, he had the second highest 5-on-5 shot attempts per 60 apparently last year on the team. So yeah, pretty good season for Noah Gregor. Maybe some of that most people aren't aware of if they're not very close Sharks followers. And I guess, yeah, let's end by talking about some prospects who haven't yet played on the team yet. I assumed, like, going into last year, I think Ryan Merkley was the player who people assumed is like the top prospect for the Sharks. Maybe that's not the case anymore. Who would you say is like the one player you're most excited about? Like, I guess a contender would be Ozzie Weisblatt, who was the 31st overall pick in 2020. He had a strong showing in the WHL and even had a cup of coffee with the Barracuda, where he had 3 points in six games as a 19-year-old this past season. I guess you've got Joachim Blichfeld, who led the Barracuda in scoring and even scored his first NHL goal in one of his five games he played with the Sharks this year. And also, for selfish reasons, I'd kind of love to get your take on a deep cut, a 2020 76th overall pick, Daniil Gushin, who had a good year last year, scored 64 points in 46 games in the USHL. I'm curious about him because I drafted him in my dynasty leagues. Yeah. Any chance? I'd be curious to know if I have a gem there. But yeah, who do you think are like the big future potential like impact guys for the Sharks?
Well, in terms of top prospect number one, I think undoubtedly Thomas Bordalo, second round pick 2020, has shot past Ryan Merkley as Sharks' top prospect. In terms of organizational consideration, I mentioned that Alex True was voted on by Barracuda management and coaching staff as Barracuda MVP. Bordalo was voted on by Sharks management for prospect of the year. That's a new thing for the Sharks organization, but that's the management doing it. Again, way more value than, you know, media or fan voting. And so Bordalo was a rookie of the year in the Big Ten, a part of the loaded Michigan team, you know, who are going to see three top 10 picks in the draft this year, Owen Power, Matty Beniers, and Kent Johnson. And Bordalo was the rookie of the year on that team. Big Ten rookie of the year, too, not just Michigan rookie of the year, Big Ten rookie of the year. Wow. And so Bordalo profiles as a top six center, maybe winger. He's a smallish guy, but he's a guy that the Sharks are tremendously excited about. And he's a guy that in a redraft of 2020 would go in the first round, you know, with ease based on the kind of season that he had. So he is the Sharks' top prospect. I think Joachim Blichfeld is a good kind of sleeper guy to key in on. I think he's kind of actually more in the layer with a Noel Gregor or John Leonard. Blichfeld scored at a half a goal pace in AHL. He has a legit NHL shot. The question, of course, for guys like that in the AHL is he going to be able to be strong enough, smart enough, and fat and quick enough to get that shot off at NHL level? Because time and space is obviously at a premium at the NHL level. So I think the jury is out on that, but he is definitely a good sleeper guy in that category where he is a guy that has 20 goal NHL potential. Whether or not he'll realize it is a big question mark, but he's a guy to keep an eye on. In terms of a Gushin is a good sleeper, but I think that it's going to be a little while though before you see him here. So in terms of, you know, he's on your team, you know, just have patience with him. Right. He did have a very good year in the USHL. He was, I think, a top five scorer in that league. And that was a league where the Chicago Steel dominated. Gushin was not on the Steel. So I think the stat is, and this was given by Doug Wilson Jr., the director of scouting by the Sharks. But he mentioned that Gushin was basically the only non-Chicago Steel player to be in the top five in the USHL of scoring, whether that is total points or average, you know, points per game. So that's pretty impressive. And so I think he definitely had a leap of a year as opposed to his first season in the USHL, or I'm not sure if it was first season, but the year before. But he's a guy that you know, got to have patience with him, though. You know, he's not going to step in next year. He's going to go to the OHL, to Niagara, which he was supposed to do this past season, except that there was no OHL season. So let's see how he does there in the OHL. And if he kind of keeps that pace up, then maybe you have like a Kevin LeBanc kind of sleeper or something like that.
Yeah, okay, well, thanks for breaking down some of these prospects, and I guess we have a future prospect coming soon because the Sharks have landed the 7th overall pick in the 2021 draft. I saw you wrote an article recently looking back at some past 7th overall picks. Is it, I guess, Shane Doan is the best ever, in your opinion, of all the 7th overall picks?
Well, you know, we had two Hall of Famers in that group, actually, Bill Barber and Bernie Federico. And Bernie Federico, I think, is acknowledged as a Hall of Famer who's sort of a compiler, and so maybe he wasn't the best number 7, but, you know, Bill Barber actually actually led all these number seven picks in terms of year-end All-Star team noms. So Bill Barber was a three-time year-end All-Star. Again, different from the All-Star game. Barber was a first team All-Star once and a second team All-Star twice. And so actually that's going to be, I think, the best number seven. You know, Doan was a great player, but a guy was not going to make the Hall of Fame, I think. And, you know, he's sort of a Hall of the Very Good kind of player, right?
So, oh, I see.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Speaking of that, by the way, before getting back to the draft really quickly, yeah. We've been having this discussion on our patron Discord about Patrick Marleau. Do you think he's like a sure, I guess now that he's like got the record for most games played ever, like it's probably a sure shot for the Hall of Fame. But in general, like, what do you think of him? Because some people were like, he's like Hall of Very Good. I think that exact quote is what I've heard.
Marleau's
had a very good career, but not like a, this outstanding career. What do you think about Marleau's career that, like, looking back over?
Yeah. I think even if you take out the record, let's take out the record, because I think with the record, he now becomes a shoo-in. Without the record, though, I think he still makes it, but maybe, you know, it takes a little longer. Maybe he's a guy, you know, 30-year, you know, veterans committee guy or something like that. Obviously, the obvious comps to Marleau, because Marleau was a bit of a compiler, too, like a Mark Recchi, that sort of thing. But, you know, there's a point where you compile so much that, hey, you're over 500 goals, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, and so that sort of, it's not automatic, but that's sort of like, okay, you know, he's compiled enough, you know. You know, we talk about Shane Doan. You know, Shane Doan had compiled for a few more years, then he certainly, you know, suddenly Shane Doan's over 1700 games and 500 goals. Okay, you know, then you know, compiling in it itself is a real skill. Not very many players obviously can keep up a high standard, you know, 20-30 goal pace for, you know, about, you know, almost 20 years, like Marleau did. So yeah. So I think overall, I think the record cinches it. But I think even before he was in, you know, he wasn't necessarily the, you know, top 50 NHL player, you know, the very best player. Like when you think of a Team Canada, that's a guy that's on like a you know, top 10 pick for Team Canada. But he's a guy that would have made Team Canada, you know, for any of those years that he was at his best. And that unto itself is, you know, that, you know, he was a great, great player. He wasn't elite, but, you know, great. So
yeah, and plus, like, just the fact that he was able to be a great player and like never get injured is like a very interesting skill in itself. But okay, but back to the draft. I just wanted to ask, like, what are you hoping the Sharks do with the 7th overall pick? Like, are you hoping that they take one of these Thomas Bordeleau teammates from the University of Michigan?
Yeah. Actually, you know, I'm hoping that they just draft the goalie, so I don't need to write. So we can, you know, it's nice to, if you're covering, like, say, at Tampa Bay and you have Vasilevskiy, and you really don't have to, like, worry about the goaltending and, you know, worry about it, you know, just shaping your coverage. Like, you're set in net, kind of, you know, and you don't have fans, you know, complaining to you about the goaltending and buying out the goaltending all the time. It's nice to kind of set it and forget it, right? Mm-hmm. And even for a writer, it's kind of nice to have a position that's set it and forget it. So it'll be fun if they draft a Jesper Wallstedt or something like that and just hopefully solve their goaltending for next decade, you know, like the Rangers did with Lundqvist. You know, obviously that's a high bar, and Lundqvist was, of course, not a lottery pick by any stretch, not even close. But getting a set it and forget a guy like that, you know, would I'm sure the Sharks would welcome it after the last 3 years of Martin Jones. The fans would welcome it for the same reason. And even as a writer, just be kind of nice to, you know, to have a guy like that you know is going to be, you know, solid year in, year out.
Yeah, I guess a more recent example, you could even point to, like, Spencer Knight for the Panthers. All of a sudden, he, like, came in and played well in the playoffs, and now it looks like the Panthers are set. It could almost make people forget about this crazy contract they've given to Bobrovsky. So, Sheng, thank you so much for all the time you've given us. Just like last year, just an amazing interview. I guess just before we end the show, I want to ask you the same thing I asked you at the end of our interview last year. If you were able to pick one Shark that you expect to be the biggest positive surprise next season, someone that maybe people aren't expecting, you know, as much from as what he'll end up providing, and then on the other hand, like someone who you think will end up being the biggest disappointment and people are going to overrate going to drafts, who would you pick?
Right. I'm going to go with actually, I probably said this last year too, but I think it's going to be Timo, because Timo's stock has dropped even more this past year. You know, he was at, a 16 goal pace for the, you know, full season this past year, something like that. Or maybe he raised it up by the end, but not much higher than 16. And so his stock is going to be low, but there is, I promise you, a 30 goal talent there. And so he could be a great pickup. for even fantasy. I think the biggest disappointment, I'm going to go with him again, Erik Karlsson, just because Erik Karlsson will, for, you know, the next couple of years or so, still have that halo of just that greatness, you know, and we're going to see flashes of it too. And we saw it this past season. But if you're drafting him to, you know, with the hope of, if you're drafting him high with the hope of, you know, he's going to return to that Norris form, I think that that's going to be rough. You know, if you can get him later, and, you know, and I think he's still talented, but I think that he's still close enough to his sort of his prime and what people saw of that. And just in terms of just perception, that people will expect more of him than he will deliver in terms of production.
Yeah, I can see that. I really hope that in a year from now, we're not going to be talking and I'll be like, how did Erik Karlsson once again do even worse than he did the year before?
Hopefully, I hope you can tease me about it next year for all my jibes on a Keeping Karlsson name. A great name, actually, by the way. It was a great name for a decade. And I hope that he has a revival. And like I said, I really enjoy watching him, just like you guys have, you know, when he's been at his best. And so it'll be great if he can shut us up and chomp on an apple multiple times during the season.
Yeah. Hey, I know you've been writing about how you were giving away some hockey cards at San Jose Hockey Now. I've got this Erik Karlsson hockey card here, which I used to display prominently. I've been doing so less so more recently. But
well, just put out the Ottawa stuff. Put out the Ottawa stuff, and you know, that is a win-win all the time. You know, yeah. So
yeah, exactly. Okay, so speaking of San Jose Hockey Now, before I let you go, please like tell everyone where they could find all of your great work. You're such a great follow on Twitter, and I love all your articles. Yeah, just tell people what they should do to get all the best Sharks coverage.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Yeah. So just Twitter, Sheng _Peng, and my site is San Jose Hockey Now. It's a subscription site, but, you know, I put a ton of work into it in the last year. We have essentially an article every day, or if not, you know, multiple articles a day, and write a ton for it. But, you know, put a lot of work into it, into making it the best San Jose Sharks site around. And so if you're a San Jose Sharks fan, if you're an Erik Karlsson fan and you want to figure out, well, what happened to Erik Karlsson? Well, I'll be writing a couple stories about that this offseason with statistics from SportLogic, microstats from them. So things like that. So look out for stuff like that. And yeah, and so that's where you're going to find my work, all of my San Jose Sharks work at San Jose Hockey Now.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, definitely people should be going there if they want to find anything to do with the San Jose Sharks. So Sheng, thanks so much for coming on the show, and looking forward to talking to you next year, hopefully, about a more exciting season for the Sharks.
Hopefully. I like covering the playoffs, so.
Yeah. Oh yeah, you said that at the end of the last interview also. Yeah. So hopefully you'll be able to do that again soon. All right, good night.
Yeah, thanks, man.
Thanks so much again to Sheng Peng for giving us an hour plus of his Sharks expertise on Keeping Karlsson. That was a really fun interview. I hope you liked it. I'll link to all of the things that he mentioned in our show notes, his Twitter and sanjosehockeynow.com. And of course, if you like this show, we'd love to hear from you. Tweet us at Keeping Karlsson. Let us know if you're excited for the 32 Beats series. We're working hard trying to get more interviews planned. We've got one locked in for this coming Wednesday. I'm going to be talking to Prashanth Iyer all about the Detroit Red Wings. So expect that in your podcast feed soon. Make sure you're subscribed to Keeping Karlsson to get all of these beat writer interviews as we drop them. But okay, I guess, what else should I mention here? So Twitter, at Keeping Karlsson. We'd love a 5-star review on iTunes. If you want to consider becoming a patron of Keeping Karlsson right now for just $1 a month, we're giving you all the perks we can. Access to our Discord server. We're going to do a patron cast in a week or two. And everything else, check it out, keepingkarlsson.com/patron for your information there. Good luck to everyone who made it to round 2 of the Keeping Karlsson playoff pool. And it'll be very exciting to see who makes it to round 3. There's 8 divisions right now, and you're going to have to win your division to make it to round 3. There's going to be a final 8, and I think we're going to do one of the round 3 drafts on the podcast. That's going to be really fun. But okay, with that, I'm going to let everyone go home. So let's cue the outro music, and I guess I'll go ahead and read you the credits, which are simple. It was myself researching the show, mainly using frozen tools, and then it was the great Sheng Peng at Sheng_Peng on Twitter, at San Jose Hockey Now. It's at SJ Hockey Now, actually, on Twitter, and then sanjosehockeynow.com. Again, it's all linked in the show notes. So thanks again, everyone, for listening, and we'll be back at you with another beat writer interview in a few days. And until then, of course, remember that fantasy hockey is for everyone.